So a few weeks ago, I kicked off a new ongoing series called Then and Now. The premise is pretty straightforward, but it clearly resonated with a lot of you based on the positive response, so thanks for that. Essentially, in each episode, I take a photo that I edited and shared from years ago and see how changes in my aesthetic preferences and advancements in Lightroom would affect my editing approach to the photo today. So for episode 2 of Then and Now, we're going way back, 13 years and 8 months to be precise. This was back when I was a Canon shooter and tended to capture 9 auto exposure brackets for every single composition, which is totally ridiculous. The photo that we're going to look at today was taken in Oregon of the iconic Vista House at Crown Point. So let's dive in. All right, so straight up, I'm just going to apologize for this photo. I mean, this is what I thought looked good like all those years ago. You can see this was taken February 5th, 2012. It was with the Canon 5D Mark II. I had my beloved Funkbuster Canon 15mm f2.8 fisheye lens. And this, you can see by the file name, it has this HDRX. This means that I must have taken all of the brackets. I think I was shooting 9 exposures. I was using this device called a promote control to take 9 auto exposure brackets. So it would be 0, -1, -2, -3, -4, and then +1, +2, +3, +4. And for a photo like this over here, there is absolutely no reason to have tone mapped this image. In hindsight, I realize that I've become a lot more discerning and better at being able to know, just looking at a scene, also knowing my camera and its capabilities, if I need to bracket, which is becoming almost never these days. I mean, camera sensors have gotten just so ridiculously good that I can get pretty much all the tonal information I need in a single RAW file. So, you know, the point about HDRX is I was using an app called Photomatics, which I mean, most people who are into HDR, specifically tone mapping, I should be precise, probably remember Photomatics. Phenomenal app. I believe it was just some like French guys who put it together. And it was a company called HDR Soft, if I remember correctly. But I use this app religiously. And so when I look at this photo, there's so much about it that I just, it makes me sad, makes me cringe. Like this gradient, like this, like these dirty clouds, which was a telltale sign of poor tone mapping. But it goes from like this weird dark color to this, like you could see this like section here of this like neon blue and then dark here and just overly crushed contrast, like really, really, like let's go to the edit stack here. Yeah, I mean, you could see here we're definitely crushing shadows, got a little bit of blown highlights. That's okay though, because that's the sun. That's like the brightest light source we have. And so it's okay to have blown out highlights there. But overall, just a really rough edit. I have worse. Well, let me tell you this. I have far worse, which will probably, they'll make their way into this series eventually. But for the most part, I just wanted to kind of start with this. And so I have, this is the unedited photo. Like you could see it's one of the brackets. And so a few things. One, just looking at the histogram here, even though this is a Canon 5D Mark II, I know I can pull all the tonal information I need. So let's start with our edit. The first thing I'm going to do, I'm going to get rid of distractions. So let's go ahead here to the remove panel. I'm going to use gen remove here. And you know you're using gen remove because this checkbox is enabled. If you have this checkbox disabled, then you'll be using the older content aware heal. So let's go ahead here. I want these cars to be gone. So right there. I also want this security camera gone. And then also this little drain pipe. So I'm going to show you a little cool trick in case you don't know. Let's say I start with a stroke here, and then I just want this straight line down here. If I press and hold the shift key and then click, we'll create a straight line connecting the last spot to where you are now. And for the most part, I think that's good. We're going to do some cropping, so I'm not worried about like this area over here. So I'm going to go ahead and click on remove. All right, let's review each area. So let's start here, and I'm going to see what other variations we have. And that's okay. That's good. That's good. I think that's okay. I don't think anyone's going to be analyzing it too much, but the other two variations weren't as good. And if I really wanted to, I can generate another three, but that's fine for now. Let's go ahead. I'm looking up here. You would never know that there was a security camera, so that's perfect. And then let's see what we got here. Let's click on this pin and see what other variations we have. That's pretty good. I'm going to stick with number two. That looks good. And so let's just kind of toggle and see. Yeah, I mean, listen, I'm using AI. I'm using Gen Remove to get rid of those things. I understand that I'm making some material changes to the original image. If this bothers you, I totally get it. You don't have to use it. But for me, I'm okay with it. Like, these are small little things that I think are greater than the sum of their parts. So with that, we're done with the remove stuff. Now I'm going to move to cropping. So for cropping, I'm going to crop in a bit right around here. But the other thing I want to do is I'm going to adjust using this vertical slider. Now, actually, before I do that, let me show you what happens if you enable lens correction for this particular lens. So remember, this is the Canon 15 millimeter f2.8 fisheye. So we have a profile for that. And you see, like, I mean, it goes from this, which is admittedly distorted because of the lens, to this, which kind of attempts to give you somewhat of these kind of rectilinear lines. But I don't feel like it works here. So I'm going to keep the original image, but I will go to crop here, and I'm going to use this vertical slider to kind of straighten it out a bit. So something right around here. Now you can see that came at the expense of some of the pixels of the composition. We kind of did this little bit of a distortion. So I'm going to click on this constraint crop checkbox. And we've got the moon right there. So I'm just going to crop it. It's too close to the edge of the frame. So I'm just going to crop in. I really don't need it. Overall, though, I think the composition here is looking good. Actually, let me rotate this a bit. So that's too much. There. Okay, that's looking good. And actually, I'm going to crop in this way too. Okay. So overall, like, not too bad. Not too bad at all. Let's go ahead. I'm going to start by applying the adaptive color profile, which I really love. And then as far as tones, let's boost the whites a bit. I'm going to open up the exposure just a bit too. And let's open up the shadows. Good. Now we have kind of like a good even exposure. See, it was a bit dark over here. We fixed that. So now I can go ahead and apply my beloved S-curve. Drop this point here. Give myself a little deeper shadow. Drop a point here. Boost the highlights. Drop a point in the middle. And let's just kind of adjust midtones. And then let's lift the black point up, add a little bit of gray. And I'm doing this, I do this for most of my photos, but I'm going to do something else as well as part of this at the end. Then I will also drop this refine saturation slider to 50. I find that's a good position. When you apply an S-curve, you will add a bit of a color boost. So this allows you to tame that back a bit. Now let's see, I didn't do a custom white balance, but let's just see what happens here. Yeah, pretty close. Doesn't really, I mean, we were pretty on point with the camera, so that's good. Now let's go down here, and one of the last things I'm gonna do is under color calibration, I'm gonna add a boost to the blue primary saturation. So let's increase this just a bit. You can see if I go to town, like, I mean, it really is, it looks good, albeit very strong. So you only need a little bit of a boost here. Now, color calibration, there's an equivalent panel in Classic called Calibration. It's usually at the very bottom of the develop module. Also in Lightroom, it's hidden by default. So you'll click this tri dot here and select Show Color Calibration to display this. I'll leave a card right here. I have a whole video on how this works, this panel, so check that out. And now we're ready for some localized edits. So I'm gonna go ahead here to masking, and this is pretty much where we're gonna spend the rest of the image. So we'll go and select landscape. Lightroom will analyze the image and identify attributes that it can see. And so you can see it found several. I'm gonna start by selecting a sky. And then I definitely want architecture. So let me see, there's architecture and then there's artificial ground. You see, I want these as at the same time. So I'm gonna start by creating a sky mask here. I'm gonna go back, I'm gonna go to landscape, and I'm gonna select architecture and artificial ground, and I'm gonna deselect this option. I think this is selected by default. If I selected this right now, we would have one mask for the artificial ground and one mask for the architecture. But I want them both on the same mask. So that's why I'm deselecting this. I'm going to go ahead and click create. So let's rename these really quickly. I'm going to call this sky. And then this one is, I'll just call this architecture. Now, you can see with architecture, though, you can see the, like the background here, it selected some of the mountains. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to subtract, go back to landscape, and I'm going to select mountains. And so it's going to remove that from the mask. And so now you can see when I hover over, it doesn't have those mountains in the background. All right, let's start with sky. I'm going to go ahead, pretty much always add a little bit of dehaze to the sky. It just brings out more contrast and a little bit of a saturation boost. Then let's go to architecture. So for architecture, I'm going to zoom in here and, of course, some texture here. And, I mean, it just does such a beautiful job of bringing out this rich texture in the masonry. Also add a tiny bit of a clarity boost. So, yeah, let's toggle this and see what it does. Yeah, very nice. I'm also going to open the shadows up just a bit. All right, so I'm looking at the sky now, and it reminds me of what I was saying with the previous image where there was like this weird kind of change and there's like a color gradient. And so I want to kind of fix that. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to create a linear gradient, and I'm going to make that selection there. But I know that I don't want the structure. I don't want Vista House in here. So let's go ahead and subtract. We'll go to landscape and we'll select architecture. And that will give me kind of this clean section here in the sky. I'm going to increase exposure and, I don't know, try to match the color a bit. I'm also going to desaturate that area. Right around there. Now, by increasing the exposure, I kind of blew out this cloud. So let me see. This might work. I'm going to subtract. I'm going to go to luminance range, and I'm going to select this bright area here. That did a pretty good job. Now let's see, if I bring it to the left, it's moving the darker point. So I'm going to, because here, as I bring it to the right, it's adding more of the bright area, which I don't want. I want the opposite. So I'm going to bring it to right around here. All right, let's see how this mask looks. That's not bad. That looks pretty good. All right, cool. So we've pretty much, I think for the most part, blended the sky a little bit better. So let's rename this. We'll call this sky blend. And let's see, just overall, the masking edits. So this is without any masks. This looks good. I'm happy with this. Now what I can do is create a custom vignette. So I'll select a radial gradient here, make this vignette over here. I'm going to bias it more around the Vista House here. Let's rename this to custom vignette. And then, of course, let's invert because we want the selection to be outside of the radial gradient. And so let's drop that exposure here. Actually, let's move this right around here. Okay. Let me see. No, you know what? I'm getting rid of it. I don't like it. We're going to go without it. All right. This is how I edit. Like this was pretty much a live edit. I had a rough idea of what I wanted to do, but I really wanted to show you just almost like unscripted how I would go about editing this photo. So that just wasn't, I wasn't feeling it. I thought maybe a custom vignette would work, but here's something that I do want to add to the photo. This is something straight up I never use. I don't know in my entire YouTube channel I've ever used this slider. And it's only until recently, I was having a conversation with a colleague of mine on the Lightroom team, and we were talking about grain. And I have nothing against grain. And I think grain is becoming more and more popular as obviously film photography has kind of been back in the limelight for the past, I'd say, 5-10 years. And certainly editing styles and film simulations with Fujifilm and other camera companies that are trying to create these film looks, grain is a natural component of film. So I think here, if I go down, I mean, I never use grain, but it's right here under effect. It's always been here. You might have it like this. So I recommend expanding so you have more control. And so I mean, if I bring it all the way, that's generally how I start. If I'm unfamiliar with a tool, I bring it to 100. So here, this is grain at 100, the size. So I'm looking at the grain here. I suppose I can zoom in. I could take the size and bring it all the way. And that just looks terrible. Like, let's zoom out. Yeah. I mean, it's interesting. Looks like you're photographing through a very dirty, foggy piece of glass. So let's undo that. And then roughness, that looks like it adds contrast to the grain. So let's bring it down to, yeah, no, I think for now, I'm just going to stick with the grain amount. And so I'll bring it to halfway. That's somewhere right around here. I would say 40 looks good. And so if I toggle this, yeah, I mean, I like this. And so basically, I mentioned earlier how lifting the black point, there was something I was going to do in addition to that, which I don't do, and that's add grain. So as I add grain, I feel like it gives me a bit more latitude to add even more gray into the black point. And it works well. Like, I might actually add a little bit more grain now. So let's see, something right around. That looks good. I mean, it's a bit, I would say maybe it's a bit heavy-handed. I'm going to back off a bit. Somewhere right around there. But yeah, I mean, I like this. Let me see if I hit the backslash key. That's what we started with. I think the grain really works well here. Now, mind you, I applied grain in the global editing panel. If you go to masking, when we go to that architecture mask here, you could add grain, but I don't know. You could see here it says size and roughness are shared globally and across all masks. Just something to know here. So if I bring the size down to 20 and then I go back to the global tool here, you can see that the size was changed to 20. So that's fine. But my point in showing you in masking is, in theory, if I didn't want grain in the sky, I could have only added it to the architecture mask. But I feel like that would look weird. I've seen similarly, people ask for the ability to have denoise applied in a local way, like to create a mask and apply AI denoise only to that mask. And I don't know, that denoise feels like a global edit, just like grain does, the more I think about it. So, but let me know in the comments what you think. If you see grain as both a global and a local edit, and if it is a local, I'd be interested to know how you would apply it locally. So to just wrap things up, again, I'm going to go to grid here. I'm going to select our original photo and our edit. Let's put them in compare. And so looking at the composition, I definitely like what I did here. In fact, I feel like I should rotate this a little bit more, but it's fine for now. But definitely just, I mean, it's completely, it's like two different photos in terms of the editing style. So I really like what I'm, you know, where my aesthetic and the tools in Lightroom, where they are now. I the more I look at this, the more I'm a fan of the grain. I'm going to probably experiment with this some more. Maybe even a video on like different creative ways to use grain with your photos. So keep an eye out. Make sure you're subscribed to the channel. But let me know what you think. I mean, there might be people out here who are like, no, you know what? The original 2012 version is better. Totally get that. But I'm a big fan of the 2025 edit. So with that, I hope you're enjoying this Then and Now series. I'm finding it a lot of fun. It's very edifying for myself as well. Of course, these are just small components to Lightroom. There's so much more to it. So if you want to learn everything there is to know about Lightroom desktop, mobile, and web, check out my course called Lightroom Everywhere. Link is in the description below. And if you missed the first episode of this series Then and Now, it's right over here, so be sure to watch that. If you found this video helpful, a thumbs up does help the channel, and please be sure to subscribe and click on the bell icon to get notified of all future videos. Thanks a lot, everyone.